Hello friends, now I will be talking to you about Hodgkin lymphoma, also known as Hodgkin's disease. So first of all, let's see what the definition of this. It is a malignant transformation of the lymphocytes, primarily in the lymphatic tissue or lymph nodes, right? And as far as age involvement is concerned, it is bimodal. That is, one is around 10 to 15 years and other is above 50 years. So, one group of people are young patients in the age of teens and other are elderly people. And most of the time they are idiopathic, but they may be associated with Epstein-Barr virus and HIV. They are the two strong association of Hodgkin disease. Now, let us talk about types. One is, we have classical. Other category is non-classical. The two broad types what we see in these patients. Okay. So, in the classical variety, we have nodular sclerosing. This is the most common type. Second is mixed cellularity. Third is lymphocytic rich. And the fourth is lymphocytic depletion. Lymphocytic rich has the best prognosis. This is the most poor prognosis. Depletion has the most poor prognosis. Now, in this variety, Stein-Reed-Sternberg cells, they are usually positive. And these, regarding CD marker, they are CD15 positive, CD30 positive, but CD45 negative. As far as non-classical is concerned, this include nodular lymphocytic predominant. Here, Reed-Sternberg cell are infrequent, but popcorn cells are present. And these patients are CD15 negative, CD15-30 negative. Remember, they are positive. This for 45 negative, but they are 45 positive. But in addition, they are CD20 positive. So this is the immunohistochemistry, and the cells Reed-Sternberg and Reed-Sternberg cell are uncommon, but popcorn cells are there. So this is the type of Hodgkin disease. Now let's see how patient comes to us. The clinical feature: Hodgkin disease is localized usually in around 70 to 80% cases. This is in contrast to non-Hodgkin lymphoma, where at the time of presentation, disease has already spread to the other places in 70 to 80% cases. So you can say this is a localized disease, and non-Hodgkin is rather systemic disease. Now, lymph nodes are involved. Classically, cervical and supraclavicular. Clavicular. That means neck region is more commonly involved. Now, what is the specialty of this lymph node involvement? It is contiguous involvement. That means it goes in sequence, in line. Unlike non-Hodgkin lymphoma, where it is non-contiguous, it may spread generalized. And this lymph node R, they are rubbery, non-tender, non-erythema. That means they are not tender, they are not hot, okay, they are not red. Once the redness or tenderness is there, that is indicate more of a infective or inflammatory pathology, but they are non-tender. One more feature of Hodgkin disease is Paul Epstein fever. Paul Epstein fever. What is this? Here, patient has fever for 2-3 weeks. Again, fever disappears for 2-3 weeks. So, patient has cyclic fever. Cyclic fever. Or fever is periodical, is there. And classical symptom or itching occur after a bout of alcohol. It's a classical feature of Hodgkin disease, what we see. One more thing, extra lymphatic sides are uncommon. This is in sharp contrast to non-Hodgkin lymphoma, where extra lymphatic site involvement is very common. And one more thing, cerebellar degeneration can occur in this patient, but this is due to autoimmune phenomena, that is due to anti-TR antibodies. This is a so-called paraneoplastic feature. It is a paraneoplastic feature. Okay. So, patient has come to us with a long history of fever, fatigue, generalized symptom. Now, how to investigate this case? Best initial investigation is excisional biopsy of the lymph node, Can we do fine needle aspiration? No. Fine needle is never the answer, because if you do fine needle, you get only few cells which may look normal. Hence, the best investigation is, you can say, best initial or other most confirmatory, both answer is excisional biopsy. And extra point, FNAC is never done. Then the next step is, other than the routines, we talk about chest X-ray, CT, PET, MRI. Why they are done? This is to know the staging of the disease. That is because single most important prognostic feature is staging, about which I'll talk shortly. What else we get? In CBC, we may get eosinophilia, very prominent feature. ESR is raised, and even the platelet count may be increased. Now, staging. This Ann Arbor staging is very, very, because this indicates the prognosis. Is the single best parameter is to know about prognosis also, prognosis and treatment plan. We plan treatment about this only. So, let us see. Stage 1, single lymph node or extra lymphatic site is involved. Two or more than two lymph node, but on the same side. Stage 3, two or more than two nodes, but both side of diaphragm, same side of diaphragm. Both side of diaphragm, and diffuse disease is grade 4. So, now what is subclassification? We also have subclassification. Subclassification is A or B. Asymptomatic, but B has either fever or weight loss of more than 10% or night sweat. So systemic feature like this, they constitute B symptom, but here none of the symptom is there. Now what are the poor prognostic feature? Poor prognosis is seen feature are if age is above 45 year. You remember the patient has bimodal presentation. That means those patient who present later on, they have a poor prognosis. Stage 4, that is diffuse disseminated disease, has a poor prognosis. Patient having B symptom like fever, weight loss of more than 10% night sweat, they carry poor prognosis. Mediastinal mass is there, again poor. Lymphocytic depletion variety, I told you they have the worst prognosis. So remember, Ann Arbor staging is very essential in the prognosis and staging. So now we plan for the treatment. In the treatment for stage 1 and 2A, 1A, 2A, you go for radiotherapy. Remember, A means 1 and 2 lymph node confined to one side of diaphragm, and A means there are no B symptoms, fever, weight loss and night sweat, no. But patient having 1B, 2B, 3 or 4, we plan for chemotherapy. Now what chemotherapy we plan? We have two regimes, either ABVD regime or MOP regime. Let us see what are the drugs which included in this category are. A for Adriamycin is the trade name of Doxorubicin. Bleomycin, B for Vinblastin and Decarbazine. Then we have MOP regime, Mecloethamine. Oncovin is the trade name of Vincristine, Procarbazine and Prednisolone. They are the two usual regime which are followed in a case of Hodgkin lymphoma. Let's compare the two. ABVD and MOP regime. Effectiveness, this is more effective, less effective. Sterility is more in this category, less in this category. Secondary pregnancies are less, more in this category. By and large, ABVD is better than MOP regime. Okay. So now let's see, we have the some patient to whom we are giving radiotherapy and there are some patient to whom we are giving chemotherapy. Let's see, what are the risk of doing radiotherapy? Increased risk of solid tumor like lung cancer, thyroid cancer and breast cancer also. That's why periodically mammography is essential. Premature coronary artery disease is the other risk factor for radiotherapy. Now what the risk factor of chemotherapy? Acute leukemias, so-called secondary leukemias, I was talking to you. Myelodysplastic syndrome, or even it can induce non-Hodgkin lymphoma, that means disease may be more spreading. So now we have given patient radiotherapy. If relapse, the relapse occur, how to do, what to do? If relapse occur after radiotherapy, then you switch over to chemotherapy. Remember, radiotherapy we have given in stage 1A and 2A. You have given, and because it's a localized disease, more in the cervical area, if relapse occur, go for chemotherapy. But relapse occur after chemo, then you have to give extra high dose of chemotherapy. That means you continue with chemotherapy but with the extra high dose. This is how we are going to manage a case of Hodgkin lymphoma, so called Hodgkin disease. Thank you very much.